Good morning, everybody. I'm going to wait a few more seconds and then we're going to start the program for today. Okay, good morning and welcome to the third fall Generative AI information series co-organized by BU's Digital Learning and Innovation and Center for Teaching and Learning. I'm Chris De La Rocas, Associate Provost for Digital Learning and Innovation, and I'm going to be your host tonight, today actually, this morning. Okay, so before we proceed, let's go through some logistics of the session.
Okay, so good morning, everyone. I'm Cindy Vincent, Communications Manager for Digital Learning and Innovation. So just a quick reminder, for optimal viewing experience, you can change your view options. And we recommend speaker view over gallery view so you can see the slides that we're presenting and the speakers more clearly. Also optional at this point in time, if you want to add your department, program, or school to your Zoom name so we know where everyone's coming from. Also any gender pronoun preferences that you have. Next slide, please. And also to let you guys know, we will be recording the session for those who couldn't attend today's session. I will be sending out an email, today's Wednesday, so later this week, with a post survey as well as information to our website on where you can access today's recording, the slides we're presenting, as well as links to the resources that are referenced in today's session. Next slide. And then lastly, we have our Q&A feature. So I do recommend everyone take a second right now. If you look at the bottom of your Zoom screen, you'll see that little Q&A box. If you pop that open throughout today's session, you can go ahead and submit your questions to the Q&A box. And towards the end of the session, we will have a Q&A session, a section of our session, where I will be moderating questions for today's presenters. And I think that's it.
Hey, let me pass the baton on to Matt, who is the co-host for today's session.
Hi, thanks, Chris. So I'm really sorry that I came in a little late. I was having some technical difficulties with Zoom, but it's great to see you all here and welcome to this third information session, developing course materials with AI with Chris De La Rocas. I'm Matt Parfit. I'm Associate Professor of Rhetoric at the College of General Studies, and I'll be moderating the discussion now that I'm here, moderating the session. So I think our first order of business, if we haven't already done this, is to ask Cindy to cover some logistics. Cindy, yeah. As you may know, we've already done that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, great. Okay, then. It's my pleasure to introduce Chris De La Rocas. I think we'll be spending about 30 minutes with his presentation, his material, and then about 20 minutes for discussion. Chris, as many of you know, is Associate Provost for Digital Learning and Innovation and Shipley Professor of Management at Questrom. He's been the Associate Professor since Associate Provost since 2016, and he leads the advancement of activities that enhance education at Boston University through the strategic use of digital technologies. And with that, I'll hand it over to Chris.
Again, thank you, Matt. I certainly had fewer things on my mind as associate professor, so I am sometimes looking back nostalgically in those days. So, okay. Hi, everybody, once again. So this is the third session of our ongoing fall generative AI information series. The first two sessions took place in August, and the recordings are available on our site. I have the link up on this slide. We have two more sessions scheduled for this fall. In October, we have a session where we will discuss the student's perspective on generative AI. And then in November, we will discuss the hot topic of what do we do with assessments in the era of generative AI. We have more topics planned for the spring. How can we use generative AI as a learning assistant for our students? introduce some of the newer tools other than ChatGPT and Bard and Bing that I think most of us know about, equity and ethical considerations, and we are open to other topics. So if you have suggestions and ideas about other topics we might want to cover in the series, please do send us email. I have my email at the end of this presentation. So why this session? So this session is designed to show you how we as instructors can use ChatGPT, Bard, Bing, and other generative AI tools in our own work as assistants that will help us design and improve course materials. So we decided to start the fall series, if you wish, the semester with the session for two reasons. First of all, using ChatGPT and similar tools in your own work is a fun and useful way for all of us to gain firsthand appreciation for its capabilities and limitations. And in a way, the overarching goal of what we're doing this semester is we are hoping to give you inspiration and information that will get all of us up to speed with the technology, because a more informed faculty will be able to make better policy decisions. And it's important for all of us to understand how these tools are used by using them in our own work. Also, using those tools in your own work to help you do things that previously you had to do, you know, yourself, is a fantastic opportunity to reflect on a lot of the burning questions that pertain to our students. You know, as you're using those tools to do the things we're going to show you, reflect, does this assist me to grow as an instructor, or does it make me lazy and impede my growth? I mean, you know, it's a good question to ask, right? Does it change the skills that are needed to be an effective teacher? And also, what is the best way to integrate AI into my workflow so that me and AI are greater than the sum of its parts? I mean, these are very, very important questions that relate not just to teaching, but to every profession as AI is entering the world. And this is a good opportunity to do that. So what we're going to do today is we're going to show you a number of examples of how one can use, all of the examples today will be on ChatGPT, but how one can use generative AI to assist teaching and the generation of course materials. We have divided the examples into four parts. We have tried to cover examples from a variety of disciplines, but you know, given how broad this field is, I'm sure we won't be able to satisfy everybody, but we've tried. And then we'll discuss some considerations and pitfalls as you use these technologies in this type of activity. And finally, of course, we'll leave plenty of time for Q&A. So the first set of examples that we want to share with you is how you can use generative AI to develop and improve course syllabi. So I'm going to go right into the first example. The way we're going to work is, actually, let me show you right away. So in order to avoid any snafus and to save some time, we're not going to do a live demo. We have already worked out the examples, right? And what we've given you are links to the so-called chat log. The way that you can generate a chat log, if you have a chat, let's say with ChatGPT, and you go to the top right corner, you see there's the little icon here, and then you can click share chat. This can help you generate a link that then you can share with the world. And then this includes the entire chat, and other people can see what you've done. So in this example, I mean, every summer I teach an intensive class on data management at the Questrom School of Business. And I've been teaching this class for a long time, right? And it's reasonably successful, but to be honest with you, I'm this is a generally stable material, but I'm wondering, how is my syllabus stacking up and how can I improve it and how can I improve the course? So what I did is I basically took the syllabus document, and then I selected the whole text and then cut and pasted it into the prompt, right? There are better ways to do that, and Matt will show you an example of how you can actually read the entire PDF, right? But it's important before I do that to basically set the stage. So see what my chat is. So I say, I am an information systems professor. I teach an introductory data management course to first year MBA students. It is always a good idea before you do any chat to set the stage and say who you are or who you want ChatGPT to act as and what the audience of the output is, right? So act as a professor of information systems and my audience are, you know, first year MBA students. So I gave it the syllabus and asked it to provide constructive feedback on the strengths and weaknesses of the syllabus as well as on the content of the course. Right. So I gave it the entire syllabus and then it came up with, as I hope you will agree with me when you look at it on your own, pretty good and balanced set of feedback in terms of both strengths and the weaknesses of my syllabus. And then it gave me some suggestions. Tell me, how can you improve the content? Right. It gave me a number of topics that I could actually consider adding to my course. Okay. And then basically I asked it the next question, comment on whether my syllabus is sufficiently up to date and make constructive suggestions on what I could change to make the course more current. So basically, yeah, it finds that the course is generally okay, but then it adds some very sensible ideas. Well, of course, these are a lot of ideas. And then the next prompt is, unfortunately, I cannot change the course duration, and it is important that I cover all the foundational topics at a reasonable depth. So I really cannot change any of my existing topics. So given these constraints, how would you revise my syllabus to integrate the suggestions you just made on revising the course's content? And I wasn't really sure what it was going to do there, but in fact, it came up with a very, very interesting suggestion, which is to squeeze little 15-minute mini lectures on the additional topics into my existing sessions. And I think that's actually a very interesting idea, which could in fact work. And then I picked one of the topics which I thought was particularly relevant. I teach relational databases, and there is a newer class of databases called NoSQL databases. And basically, I told it, design a lab assignment on NoSQL databases that should take students about 2 hours to complete on their own. Assume that students have no prior experience with NoSQL. I think it's very important, as I said, to set the stage and give it as much context as possible about the audience. In this assignment, include detailed instructions for installing and configuring any necessary software. That's actually very important when you do software assignments, and also provide a solution key for the instructor. Then it did all of the above. So it gave me a whole assignment. It gave me all this installation and configuration instructions, which are usually very tedious for us to write on our own. It gave me an assignment which is decent, and then it gave me also some solutions. So that's an example of how I used the tool to refine an existing syllabus. I have another example here of how one could use ChatGPT to create a syllabus from scratch. And I chose a topic that I know nothing about. Well, I know something about, but it's not really on my field. I said, you're a political science professor. I want your help to design a 7-week undergraduate case-based course on understanding revolutions, right? Of course, I could just leave it at that. Right, and ask it, you know, give me the syllabus. But usually you'll find that doesn't give you optimal results. What I found in my experience works best is to start with the learning outcomes, right? I mean, it's very important to pin the learning outcomes of a course. So I say, first, suggest 3 alternative sets of possible learning outcomes for such a course. So it gave me 3 sets of learning outcomes around the course on revolutions. Historical and theoretical foundations, social and political implications, and then some global perspectives. Okay, and actually I thought that they were pretty reasonably done. Then I said, I would like my course to focus on learning outcome set 2. I like that the best. Please design a syllabus for this course. I want every course session to be based on a reading that will be used as a basis for discussion using the case method. Please carefully select the readings for each class session and list them in the syllabus together with case preparation questions for my students. please ensure that all the readings you select actually exist. Provide their full reference, including publisher, date, and page numbers, if applicable. Now, you may have heard or experienced that one of the most notorious shortcomings of ChatGPT is that when you ask it to provide references, it often hallucinates. And here's where the concept of ChatGPT plugins come into play. If I go back into the ChatGPT, let me actually start a new chat. And by the way, I'm using ChatGPT 4, which is kind of the advanced paid version. You can use the free version, but it doesn't have all the features. So when you start a new chat and you click on the top, you see that there is an option for plugins. You click, oops, let me get down. All right. It's difficult to navigate when I have the Google. Okay, so if you click on plugins, right? Plugins are basically, well, extensions that extend the capabilities of ChatGPT. There is something called plugin store where you can go and select the ones you want and enable them. But the one that I find very useful is called Scholar AI. So Scholar AI is a plugin that is designed to overcome this notorious limitation of ChatGPT when it comes to academic references. So it actually is a plugin that searches for existing references and then incorporates existing references whenever you ask for some. Okay, so I used it in this case because it's very important when I design a new course and I introduce and I include readings for them to exist, right? Okay, so basically it used the Scholar AI. It didn't find any specific articles that were relevant, but it says I can still design a syllabus using well-known books, articles, and case studies that are commonly used in political science. So basically gave me a course, gave me a 7-week course. Then it gave me maybe 2 case preparation questions per session, which I thought it was a little thin. Then I asked it, that's the thing. If you don't get the input you expect, don't give up. What's interesting is that you can keep conversing with the tool and then, give it more specific instructions. And the tool usually tries its best to improve what it has generated. So in this case, I'm saying enhance the syllabus so that there are at least 4 case preparation questions for his reading. So it gives me a better set of questions, right? And then what you can do is once you pin down the topics and the readings, you can actually use the tool to design each of those discussion sessions in detail, right? And then I say prepare a detailed 60-minute case teaching note for week 2, the French Revolution. In the note, discuss how I will open the class with a hook designed to engage students. Provide the text of every question I will ask the class and 2 possible replies by students. Discuss how I will build on the student answers to move the discussion to the next question. So as you can see, this is pretty elaborate. And in the interest of time, I'll just let you study this on your own to decide for yourself how effectively it has done it. But it basically is doing most of the work for myself, right? And then I can even go further and help and ask it to help me design term paper assignments. And then I say, explain how each assignment reinforces the learning outcomes of the course, because it gives me some assignments and it explains why it thinks that these assignments are good and so on and so forth. So you can see, you can actually basically go and have an elaborate back and forth conversation with the tool in order to design pretty much an entire course from scratch. Okay, so that takes care of the first kind of use cases. Now, and we kind of discussed the second thing is, as I said, once you have a course, or if you have an existing course, the tool can really help you design case studies or detailed lesson plans. I'm just going to show you one example here, and then I will pass on the baton to Matt to discuss some examples of his own. So I teach business school classes, an important class for business students is negotiations. So you may have heard that what's going on right now is the strike of the auto workers. That's a very interesting negotiation case. And also what's interesting, you may have heard also that ChatGPT is trained on data which ends in 2021. So ChatGPT would not have knowledge of this event. So what I can do, however, is I can select, I went and selected an article from CNN that I thought was laying out the situation pretty well, right? And then I cut and pasted it into the system, right? And then again, I say, act as an experienced negotiations business school professor. Your task is to help me create a negotiation case study based on the following article. Read the following article and suggest three alternative sets of learning outcomes that I could focus my session on. Okay, remember, I'm very keen on starting all these explorations by pinning down learning outcomes. I think this is very, very good practice. So I give it the whole text of the article. I cut and pasted it. And then it gives me three sets of learning outcomes that I could basically base my class on. Right. I thought that test set number one, strategic planning and tactical choices, is the most appropriate for the kind of class I want to lead. Then I said, let's continue with set number one. Propose a set of questions to give my students together with the above article so that they can prepare for a class discussion based on this case. It is okay to ask students to look up additional information if needed to reflect and prepare some of the questions. Again, the more detail you give to the system, the better outcomes you're going to get. So it gives me the questions. And then, as I did in the previous example, I'm asking it to prepare a detailed case discussion plan, yada, 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 right? And what's interesting, at the end, I said, make sure the discussion ends by distilling a few key points that reinforce the planned learning outcomes for the session. And in the end, and that's kind of almost cheating, I'm even asking it to give me a script for the 5-minute conclusion part of the case discussion. So you can actually, you know, do as little or as much as you're asking it to do. Okay, so that's another example of how you can do a case study. Now I'm going to pass the baton on to Matt, who has prepared a couple of case studies and discussion exercises for his neck of the good, which is rhetoric.
Thanks very much, Chris. Yeah, I'm a rhetoric instructor. And so although I assign readings from across the disciplines, many are in the humanities. I particularly like to assign essays as distinct from, scholarly articles or textbook material. So essays, by that, I mean, in the tradition of Michel de Montaigne, the kind of thing you might read in The New Yorker, writing that's typically reflective, exploratory, often personal, but also makes an argument of some kind. And my courses are very focused on working closely with these texts on interpretation rather than on the informational content of the readings. So that was my focus as I went to ChatGPT. And I chose for my first example a very well-known essay, Ralph Waldo Emerson's The American Scholar from 1837. I figured that ChatGPT would probably do pretty well with this because it's such a well-known essay. Certainly it would have been in the training data set for GPT-3 and GPT-4. Probably a lot of commentary would have been too. There's even a short Wikipedia article on this essay. So I figured that even without having the text uploaded to it, it would probably be able to help me out a little bit. So I asked it to generate 5 discussion questions, and they're not bad. They do cover most of the main themes. They're all pertinent. None of them are, I would say, the least bit hallucinatory. I'm not sure that I would sort of use these questions exactly as they are, but they could be a good starting point, certainly in a pinch, for discussion questions that I might use in class. I wouldn't call them sort of brilliantly insightful. They're kind of general, but I probably could have pushed it a little bit further in the way that Chris has shown us how to do. But instead I turned in a different direction, and I wanted to ask ChatGPT about the metaphors. So I decided to ask it to generate 5 think, pair, share activities that focus specifically on Emerson's metaphors. And the reason for that is that the metaphors are really key to the way that Emerson makes his argument, but students find them quite complex, often quite perplexing. So they do become a focus for discussion of the text. And interestingly, ChatGPT did much less well on the metaphors. So I'd given it a couple of examples. There's a sort of one-man metaphor near the beginning. There's another metaphor having to do with fires that erupt from volcanoes. That's kind of a metaphor for the sort of one universal mind that Emerson writes about. And basically what ChatGPT did was simply to sort of take the examples from the prompt and sort of run with them a little bit. And then it kind of hallucinated a few more examples. They're not entirely hallucinatory. There is a bit of a planting metaphor. There's a bit of a lightning metaphor. If you could just scroll down a little bit more, Cindy. Yeah, a little bit of a lightning metaphor. There's not really a prominent eating metaphor that I remember in there. So these are not so good. So I think that's okay. That kind of suggests a sort of opening for students to work with in their writing and in their and in our discussion. How do Emerson's metaphors actually work in the essay? Why does AI struggle with them a little bit? It takes imagination. It takes a certain kind of worldly knowledge, perhaps, in order to figure out how these metaphors work in Emerson's American Scholar. And so I suspect that that's the kind of interpretive task that ChatGPT actually probably struggles with. It might be able to figure them out, especially if there's commentary on this somewhere in its training data set, but it didn't surprise me very much that there's this weakness. So let's move on to the next example that I have here, which concerns an essay called Joy, a really lovely essay by Zadie Smith. You may know her as a novelist. She's also an essayist. Joy came out fairly recently. I wouldn't be surprised if it was not in ChatGPT's training data set at all. What I did instead then is I uploaded the essay to ChatGPT using a plugin called AI PDF, which works quite well. I recommend it. Occasionally, it will only read the first few pages of an essay and not the whole thing, but you can usually get it to read the whole thing. And when it's working properly, it does work well. So I asked ChatGPT to come up with 5 think, pair, share activities. It did really well once it had access to the essay. I think all of these activities are pretty good activities. There's a little bit of overlap. They're not all that distinct from one another. I don't know if you'd call them brilliant or anything, but they're pertinent. They're certainly serviceable. I felt I could either use them or adapt them a little bit, and they would probably work fine in class. It's the strengths and weaknesses of ChatGPT start to emerge interestingly, as we kind of get into the nitty-gritty of the essay, though. And Cindy, I'm going to ask you to scroll down to the next prompt in the chat here. So going past these think, pair, share examples to, yeah. And I need to explain a little bit about what's going on in the essay in order to make sense of this. And it's a little hard to sum up, but basically in this essay, Smith is drawing on episodes from her own life in order to distinguish between joy and pleasure, between rare moments of true joy and lesser moments of mere pleasure. And fairly early on, she describes a night out at a dance club in London that she said was like joy. In writing about it, she said it was like joy, but not really joy. And at this nightclub, she met a man she calls Smiley. She goes home with him. And she describes her feelings the next morning. So I asked ChatGPT, all right, at one point, Zadie Smith writes, was that joy? Probably not. What does she mean by that? Why was it probably not joy? And ChatGPT did very well at explaining in sort of cold logic why this episode was probably not joy. But if you read this answer and if you know the essay, you'll recognize that something's missing here. There's a sort of complex mix of emotions in the passage in which she writes about this. There's a subtle blend of wistfulness and regret, some humiliation, a good deal of humor. It's argument from pathos rather than logos, from subtle complex of emotion and feeling rather than strictly logic. And I think that's what ChatGPT doesn't deal very well with. So again, there's an opening. Her argument about this evening, why it was not really joy, is crucial to the argument of the essay as a whole. In order to really understand it, we've got to respond to and sort of sympathize with, recognize the sorts of emotions that she's writing about. So I'd want students to read this analysis, this ChatGPT analysis of the passage, and talk about what's missing. What's human about the way that she makes this argument that AI overlooks or can't easily identify, and use that maybe as the basis for a discussion. So I think sometimes what ChatGPT doesn't do very well is precisely the opening for an analysis, a discussion. Why is it not doing this so well? What is human about our interpretive abilities that ChatGPT has problems with? So I'm going to stop there because I think that's probably plenty for now. And, I think we're ready for discussion, no, Chris?
We still have a few things to go over, but I'm going to expedite it because indeed time is running. So thank you. That was really cool, Matt, your assessment of ChatGPT's strengths and weaknesses in these particular cases. So we have some examples of how you can use ChatGPT to develop practice problem sets and quizzes. This is a very common need for all of us. My verdict on that, and I will let you examine those examples yourselves. ChatGPT did a very good job of generating the questions. It didn't always do a good job of generating answer keys for those questions, but I will let you assess them on your own. But what I want to show you, which is kind of a fun thing, is a different way of engaging with ChatGPT, which is an iterative conversation that actually can save you a lot of time, right? So I'm very big on the notion of a hook, right? So when you start a lesson, it's always good to have something to hook the students. And it's not always easy to find. Right. So here's a conversation that I had with ChatGPT. Let me see what it is here. Right. So I'm saying, I'm a college professor teaching an introductory calculus course for undergraduate students. Your task is to suggest interesting examples, stories, or activities that I can use as a hook to engage my students at the beginning of each course session. These hooks should serve make students curious and interested in the topic I'm going to be introducing in the course session. But here's what's interesting. I say, ask me about the topic and then generate three potential hooks for this topic. Then ask me for another topic and do the same. Continue to ask me about topics until I respond, stop. So you see, instead of me typing all the time, okay, give me some topics, some hooks for topic X, Y, Z, I'm basically specifying essentially an iterative loop between ChatGPT and myself, right? So ChatGPT responds, this sounds like a fantastic way to engage your students and make the learning experience more enjoyable. Let's get started. What is the first topic you will be covering in your introductory calculus course? And then I respond, limits. Then ChatGPT comes up with arguably three very interesting and plausible hooks. Then it says, would you like to proceed with another topic? Then I say, derivative of a logarithm, which is another topic, a standard topic in introductory calculus. gives me some actually interesting hooks that I wouldn't have thought of myself, right? And then it goes on and on until I say stop, okay? So this is a very interesting way. You basically specify at the beginning that it will give you something and then it will ask you for some more input and continue until you ask it to stop, which is a very effective way. Essentially, I could do that for the entire course in a pretty effective way. So I have a couple of other examples of the same nature that I will invite you to look at on your own. So you can use the same idea to develop polling questions at the beginning and end of a course. And I chose a music appreciation class as an example. Or to ask it to give you examples of active learning activities. So an algorithms class, right? You wouldn't necessarily expect an algorithm class to be good ground for active learning, other than, of course, programming. And it came up with some pretty interesting and innovative activities for some of the topics of the course. So that's another very cool way of using the tool. And of course, whenever you use this tool to do those things, I mean, we have to be cognizant of certain limitations and pitfalls. And I know that this is a very dense slide, and you know, Matt will spend, I don't know, 3 or 4 minutes maybe giving you some highlights of some of the considerations one should have in mind when you do what we just did.
Yeah, I'll be very quick because I do want to leave time for questions, and there are already quite a few questions in the Q&A. So considerations include educational objectives. What are you including in your educational objectives, and are they in the prompts that you're giving it? Ethical implications, what kind of bias might there be that might affect your results, your outputs, and I think you need to be transparent with students about the use of AI. Accuracy is, of course, crucially important. You can double check what it produces, but I don't think it should ever be taken at face value without that kind of double checking. Are the materials accessible? There's a good deal of help online with that kind of thing. Privacy, you may need to obtain permission from students to use any of their work within an LLM tool. And finally, assessment. AI assistance is acceptable to students, at what level? Is it clear that how the use of course materials will be assessed?
Okay.
Move on, Chris?
Sure, that's good enough for now, right? Okay, so we came up with a number of examples to illustrate those points. We have more examples and ideas in a companion document that we will make available together with those slides, and of course the video of the presentation. There's a few more links to outside resources that we recommend that you take a look at, all right? And one thing I want to discuss before we move to the Q&A. So here's a very ambitious and exciting initiative we're starting. So we are launching a repository of generative AI use cases at BU. And we invite all BU instructors to share with us their own examples and experiences of using generative AI in their teaching. So things like what I've shown or anything else. You know, even the language you use in your syllabi around AI, your policies, anything you want to share with us. We have a easy to fill out Google form, and we invite you to just send us your use cases. We hope that this way we'll build a repository of use cases that we will make available to the BU community, and we can use as a basis for professional development events in the future. So again, this is the link, and it will be in the slides that we will share with you. I hope you guys contribute your use cases and examples and experiences. And at this point, we can move to the Q&A. As Matt said, we're sure you have a lot of questions. So Cindy's going to help us moderate those questions.
Thanks, Chris. You can go ahead and stop sharing your screen so that viewers can see your guys' handsome faces. Thank you. Okay, and so our first question that we have, and I just want to remind everyone, I forgot to say this at the beginning, we're using a bubble up Q&A feature. So if there are questions in the Q&A box that you think are, you really want to hear answered live during our session today, go ahead and hit that like button and they will float up to the top. So I am sure to read it out for our speakers today. So our first question is from Bridget Ritter. For the ChatGPT chat logs, how long will those links remain active? Or in other words, how long will the chat dialogue be preserved and remain accessible?
Okay, so thank you for this question. Now, this is something which is not very clear, right? I've read somewhere that they can only be active for 30 days, but if you look at my ChatGPT, everything I've done since I've started using it, which was when it was last December, I think, right? So everything is still available, right? So all of these are available, and it's not very clear. I mean, I don't believe that 30 days is valid. I mean, so those things change every day. But you know, if you're in doubt, the best thing you can do is to basically cut and paste. I mean, you know, your entire chat, put it in a document, and then send it with your audience.
Okay, thank you. Our next question is from Laura Nooney. Is there a reason you have used ChatGPT versus Bing or another generative AI program?
Well, the main reason is familiarity and habits. And also ChatGPT allows you to share chats using a chat log. Bing does not allow you to do that yet. Bard, Google Bard is another alternative that also has a sharing ability, but it's basically just habits, you know. So different people use different tools. And in fact, we're going to have a session in the near future where we're going to outline those tools and outline some of the differences and the plus and minuses.
I just throw in that although I didn't try to upload a PDF to any other tool, my understanding is that both Bard and Anthropic AI's chat interface allow you to upload PDFs. So if you don't have a subscription to ChatGPT-4 with plugins, that might be a way to work with PDFs directly or upload PDFs directly to an AI chat tool by using Bard or Anthropic.
Okay, thank you. Our next question is also from Laura Nooney. She wants to know, does the free version accommodate the use of plugins?
No, plugins are only available when you use the paid version.
Okay, thank you. Jack Wolf is asking, what is the maximum length of characters or words or pages that you can input into a single query of either the free or paid version of ChatGPT?
Okay. I think it's 4,000, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, it's I'm not sure it's 4,000 or 2,048 tokens, right? A token is a word or a punctuation. But here's what's interesting: the token limit applies to both the your prompt and the response. So roughly speaking, it's good enough for 3 to 5 pages of text. You know, that's pretty much the rule of thumb.
Okay, thank you. Our next question is from John McCall. In the example of the Whitman essay, how would you utilize AI to judge whether the students are using AI to create the essay? Recurring phrases or word use or so on?
I think you're probably referring to the Emerson essay, but in any case, the answer would be the same. You know, it's a very good question. And of course, the answer is going to depend on a prompt. So far, my experience is that the ChatGPT, unless pushed, unless the user knows how to engineer the prompt really cleverly, it's going to produce very generic writing that's full of commonplaces. It's hard to prove that that's the output of GPT, but in my experience, it doesn't write much like an undergraduate, certainly not like a freshman. And I think if you ask ChatGPT if your assignment is asking students to work with very specific elements in the text, and to reason through an argument that requires close reading and interpretation, as a rule, I don't think ChatGPT can do as well with that as an undergraduate student can do, and the difference will be pretty clear. I mean, it's really hard to sort of generalize about this kind of thing, but I think prompts that require really close reading and careful interpretation of the text are difficult for ChatGPT to simply fake.
Of course, you know, I think the one of the key elements in Matt's response is that it's difficult to prove, right? And so it's difficult to say whether an essay is written by an undergraduate who didn't put a lot of time or hasn't understood the text very deeply or with a machine. And all this is the topic that spills into one of the future sessions of this series. But my personal opinion is that it is very difficult to authoritatively say whether an essay has been produced by AI or not. At least difficult enough to accuse a student of plagiarism. So this is a losing battle. And as we will discuss in November, the better approach is to rethink your whole assignment strategy, assuming that ChatGPT will be in the picture. Right, but I will leave some suspense here. There are several methods to do that, and we have an entire session dedicated to how to handle it.
We have a couple more questions, specifically for Matt's examples, from Bridget Ritter. Did you compare the responses and metaphors ChatGPT described after uploading the actual essay instead of relying on what may or may not be in the training data?
I did not. And of course I should have. But so that'll be an interesting experiment that any of us, I think, could try, but I'll certainly try that. No, I didn't. I didn't upload the Emerson essay to ChatGPT at all. I just relied on what it already knew.
Okay, another question about the Emerson essay. How different might things be if you had added into learning outcomes the outcome you wanted? For example, what if your learning outcomes stated, students will learn the subtle difference between two similar emotions? Or even more, what if your learning objective stated, students will discern subtle differences between emotions in order to write about them, which is really two different LOs, but.
Yeah, so that's a really interesting question. I think I'm gonna answer it with reference to the Zadie Smith essay rather than the Emerson essay, because the Zadie Smith essay sort of argues from emotion much more than the Emerson essay really does. I think it's fair to say, well, sort of, arguably. In any case, I sort of pushed ChatGPT to work with the emotional qualities of the essay in a way that it didn't occur to me to do with the Emerson essay. It always comes up with an answer. I didn't find the answers very satisfactory. So I think even if you do put in a learning outcome like the one you described, Megan, I don't think it's going to do great with it. So, there's sort of nuances of emotion and feeling in the essay and in the way that we respond to an essay like this that ChatGPT just is very crude about. It's much less crude about the reasoning in the essay, which it can trace pretty well as far as I can tell. But when I asked it about emotions, as you can see, if you look at the chat log, it was, sort of superficial, cursory, not particularly nuanced or deep. I'll have to leave it at that, but I don't think adding a learning outcome would have, I'll have to try, but I don't think adding a learning outcome would have made a whole lot of difference. It just didn't seem to be particularly subtle about the emotional element in the essay.
Thank you. Our next question is from Christopher Robinson. Is BARD available within the suite of applications available to the BU community and BU Google Suite?
Okay, so I can answer that. As of today, BU has decided to not make BARD available due to privacy concerns. The thing is that it is, you know, we are concerned that because every if BU students and faculty have BARD available, they might make inadvertently some personal information or FERPA protected information available to BARD. And at this point, ISNT has decided to not make it available. This is, of course, subject to change, and your opinions and viewpoints and wishes will, of course, be taken into consideration on this topic.
Thank you. And Jim asks, what other plugins do you find useful besides Scholar AI?
Oh boy. I have to confess, I haven't used many plugins yet. I don't know if Matt has.
No, I've only used a few, and I haven't used them very extensively. There are a few others that are pertinent to, you know, academic work. I've mostly used AI PDF. There's another called Chat with PDF or something that I've used. I think there's a bibliographic. There's another, other than Scholar AI, there's another bibliographic one that I've used a little bit. I think maybe it's Litmaps. I can't remember for sure. Best thing to do is to browse through them. There are about 100 or so, right?
Yeah, so that would be a fantastic way of using the repository, right? So send us your experiments with plugins, what you find useful, what you don't find useful. These are some of the things that we could gain collective experience through this repository.
Thank you. We have time for one more question, again from Christopher. What considerations for accessibility of course content should a faculty member consider when using AI? And Christopher suggests going to the CTL site on UDL and referring to the resources there in your AI prompts, which is a shameless plug for the DL&I and CTL community pages. Thank you for that, Christopher.
Yep, that's an excellent question. It's not an area where I have personally experimented with. However, here's what I suggest that would be a great experiment. When we set up the prompt, right, and we say, I am a professor of such and such, I want to create a material such and such, you can actually say, you know, ensure that your response is consistent with UDL principles. Or you can actually say, or the other thing is, you can actually give it a course material and then say, well, please comment on how well this material is compatible or compliant with UDL or with accessibility principles. That would be very interesting. I haven't tried it, but it is a possible, it would be very curious to, I'm going to actually try it right after the session because this sparked my interest. That would be a way to discuss or bring accessibility into the picture.
I don't have much to add because I agree. It's a great question. It's a really important area, and it's not something that I've investigated as much as I probably should or hope to in the future. It is really interesting that as of yesterday or the day before, ChatGPT can now be interacted with via voice. So that certainly has accessibility implications. So students who can't or don't type on a regular keyboard and can't interact with it that way can interact with it by speaking now. But that's about all I have to add, I'm afraid. But I think that's a great area for future investigation.
And you know, what these questions underscore is that at this stage, there are no real authorities and experts on how we use ChatGPT. You see, all of us are learning. And one of the main one of the main reasons we have this series is to excite and inspire all of us to do more experimentation and collectively improve our institutional experience and learning about ChatGPT. So please, I think that's a good gateway to conclude in the session. Let me share my screen once again. So we hope that we have given you a lot of food for thought for you to do your own experiments with generative AI, your own use cases. It can actually, I think it can be a very powerful productivity tool for faculty that will free up more time for you to do, you know, first of all, to refresh your courses, build up new materials, and also spend more time with your students, right? I mean, so let ChatGPT do some of the tedious work and then you spend more time with your students. Now, a couple of parting thoughts and requests. If you have any comments, I mean, we're going to have a feedback form at the end of the session, but if you want to reach any or either Matt or myself personally, these are our emails. If you have suggestions about topics you would like us to cover in this series, please let us know. I'm listing the form here, so please contribute to our repository of use cases. And one other thing I haven't mentioned, one of the resources that DLNI has put together is a specialized grant. You can have a small grant if you want to experiment with ChatGPT in your class, and maybe you want to have licenses for ChatGPT, or actually, sorry, I keep saying ChatGPT, right? For some other tool or any tool, you can find more information about the grant in this link. And I guess that's it. Thank you so much for your attention this morning. Please experiment and let us know what happens. And Matt, thank you so much for being a co-host.
Thank you, Chris, very much. Yes. Sorry for coming in a little late. And thank you, Cindy, for your help too. This was great, Chris. Thanks a lot. And I look forward to interacting with many of you out there on this topic in future.
All right. Have a wonderful day, everybody.
Thanks. Bye.